Hey guys, welcome back to another episode of In-Depth Angling. I'm excited to record this today as we are going to be taking a look at the walleye in Stockton Lake, breaking down the patterns, locations, and baits to use to catch more and bigger walleye during the summer months. Be sure to stick with us until the end of the video as we are going to be going over a few walleye fishing spots you can go try to land your next big one. Before I go any further, if you are new to the channel, you fish Stockton Lake, or you really like walleye fishing, please consider subscribing to In-Depth Angling so you don't miss lake breakdowns and fishing videos created to help you become better anglers and catch more fish out on the water this year. All right, let's dive right into this. Stockton Lake, pictured on the screen, has 298 miles of shoreline created by the dam on the north side of the lake and has two major channels from the Little Sack and Sack River arms that merge on the lower end of the lake in a V shape. Also become significantly wider after they both merge. There's some islands out here in the middle and a few different channels that kind of swing right up here against some of these banks along and then kind of funnel their way out through the north section of the dam. As you go further up here towards the southern end of the lake on either the Little Sack or Big Sack arms, it becomes a lot shallower. There's more trees. It's a little bit more of a narrow channel. You guys can just see the width of the channel over here is really not that big, and it only gets down to about 25, 30 feet in depth, as opposed to down here on the northern end towards the dam, where it gets over 100 feet in some places. Walleye are stocked in Stockton Lake annually at 1 to 2 inches in size. 83% of walleye caught in electrofishing surveys done by the Missouri Department of Conservation in 2021 measured at or above 15 inches in length, and 11% measured over 20 inches long, so there's a good healthy population in the lake that keeps getting stocked every year. In the early summer months, walleye are fairly active, and many consider this the best time of year to catch them because of a variety of baits and patterns will work to catch these fish. Water temperatures aren't overly warm yet, and walleye are moving around in the water column to hunt bait fish, holding in a variety of different locations. A few examples of some locations that walleye like to use this time of year include points, islands, channels, and flats. We got a few different examples just here. There's an island sitting off of here with a point next to it. And then there is a couple of different channels that kind of go back into some of these coves that have got a little bit more, some deeper water and some harder cuts that can lead up to some shallower water. There's also a old river channel that kind of slams up here against this main lake point next to this island here. Great little location to try over there by Masters public use area. And as well over here on the other end of the lake, there's a big flat that kind of sticks off of here with some different points and an island sitting on top of it. Old channel, old riverbed kind of swings over here against some of this where it drops over into like 70 feet of water and then pops up over into like 16. Lots of area kind of offshore where those walleye can set up and used all through the entire summer. Walleye are nocturnal feeders, so they kind of are more active and come up shallower during the night. Makes them kind of hard to film for me, for you guys, so I can't really get like a whole lot of like walleye fishing footage very often because there's just really low lighting whenever I'm actually catching a good number of them to make a video. During the day, they'll sometimes pop off of these flats and channels and sit down in the little saddles over here where there's kind of a like middle range depth, and sometimes they'll just drop like right over the edge and suspend or hang close to the bottom in those main river channels. There's plenty of examples of locations and different structures just like this one on Stockton as you go a little bit further down the channel here. Lots of different channel swings where the old river kind of swings right over next to the bank, and then where it kind of swings away on the opposite side, there's generally some flats or some sort of like points that kind of stick out a little bit of the ways. There's a lot of old road beds in Stockton. There's all kinds of these different fingerling points that stick out and kind of jet right over next to deep water. Provides just a ton of offshore structure for these fish to set up on. And in the evening, those walleye will suspend up a little bit and feed a little bit more. And sometimes they'll go over towards the shoreline and feed too. Kind of really depends where the bait fish are though. Baits to use this time of year vary by the situation, but some of the staples to have in your tackle box this time of year are jerk baits and swim baits to cast at night. I like to use these Smithwick Rogues. They suspend really well, tend to catch a lot of walleye. Usually try to stick with more natural colors, more of like a shad, or like sometimes bluegill will be something that walleye even feed on quite heavily in Stockton from time to time. There's a lot of bluegill in there for forage. Another good little bait to try to use this time of year is those little swim baits like I mentioned, and just like something's got a little bit of rib body, it's got a little bit more action, paddle tail. Put a little jig head on there, you can fish it at different depths, close to bottom or up shallow, depending on kind of how the fish are moving throughout the night, whenever they're a little bit more active or suspended in that water column and trying to pick those fish off in the mid-range depths. Bottom bouncer rigs with night crawlers troll during the day if fish are holding tight to the bottom of the lake work really well. It just keeps your bait just like a foot or two up off the bottom as you troll. This little peg down here towards the left side of your screen is what's going to be rubbing into the bottom quite a bit. And there's going to be a leader stuck onto the end of that swivel over there that's going to be dragging behind. A lot of people tend to put a crawler harness on or something that you can rig up a night crawler with. This is a crawler harness here. There's plenty of different options, different color combinations, different blades you can use. That really depend on the speed you're going to be going at, depth you're going to be fishing, what the fish are kind of like just doing that day. It's very situational what colors and everything you're going to use. But the majority, like bare bones of it, is you're going to put a night crawler on here on those two hooks there. You're going to have some sort of blade spinning there, and you're going to troll at between around like 1 to 2.5 miles per hour. And as far as those like weights that you have going on with those bottom bouncers that I showed you guys earlier, you're going to kind of adjust those for whenever you're going to be going for deeper to shallower water. The general rule of thumb is you want about 1 ounce of weight for every 10 feet down you're fishing. So if you're fishing in 20 feet of water, you want about 2 ounce weight. If you're going up to like 25, you maybe 2.5. If you're going down all the way to 10, you might want to be just using like 1 ouncer. And that'll keep your bait from really being like too light or too heavy to where it's not going to run correctly, and you're going to avoid getting hung up quite as much. But fish are not always stuck and glued down to the bottom. Fish are sometimes suspended from the bottom of the lake on cloudy days and actively feeding on bait fish. And when that's going on, I like to change from bottom bouncer rigs to trolling crankbaits. And a few of the different crankbaits I really like to troll are these Berkeley flicker shad like this. I like to usually stick within fairly natural shad color or something that's got just a little bit of a slight variance to it. Could look something kind of like this, where it's got a little bit of some different sparkle or whatever on it. That doesn't matter usually like a whole lot. The fish will kind of tell you what they want as you're going along, and you can switch around with some colors and different sizes. Another crankbait I really like to use and troll, shad wraps from Rapala. You got jointed and regular shad wraps, different colors. Brighter colors can sometimes work with these, just kind of like the flicker shad. Generally keep them at least somewhat resembling natural shad colors on Stockton Lake, just because the water is generally fairly clear. When trolling crankbaits, though, you're going to be catching a lot of other fish besides walleye. The main thing is to be able to look at your electronics, have good electronics, and be able to find out where bait fish are, because active walleye and feeding fish in general are going to be near their food. They're not going to be like completely set off by themselves usually, where there's no bait fish around. If you've seen stuff like that on your graph, those are generally inactive fish that aren't usually feeding heavily. If you're seeing a whole bunch of fish where there's some bigger arches underneath, like a big school of shad on your graph, those are going to be fish that are actively up, suspended, chasing bait fish trying to feed. And those could be a variety of different things. You can't really usually tell on the graph what they are. Trolling crankbaits through those areas, you're going to be catching all kinds of stuff from catfish, bass, white bass, crappie, and of course walleye, what we're trying to target. These are just a few of my favorite crankbaits to use. I also like to use Hottentots and Bomber A cranks to troll with. They seem to have decent luck with me, but these are my two favorite ones. They imitate shad really well in the profile, and they have different sizes that I can kind of swap around depending on the size of the bait fish that time of year. If you guys got a different crankbait you like to use, comment down below. I'd like to hear it from you. In these longer coves like this, there's plenty of bait fish, and walleye like to use them as well to hunt in. Walleye tend to use the lower ends of these coves during the early part of the summer, but as we get further into the heat and the water temperature can rise up into the upper 80s to low 90s, these fish really like to hang out more and more towards deeper water access and gravitate more towards the main channel where the old river channel is. These flats over here, like I showed you guys before, has got this big drop off over here indicated by all these dark bands right here where those contour lines are tied together. It's a steeper drop off, and it jumps up here this blue where it's shallower. Great location for those fish to come up to and feed during the active hours, and then drop back off to where that cooler water is, and those fish will kind of slide back off into there. When this happens, walleye don't stop feeding, but they tend to slow down and become more lethargic during the day. A thermocline can set up in the lake that both bait fish and walleye will relate to whenever they suspend in the water column to feed. When the dam releases enough water, slow current moves along the bottom of the lake. As current moves from the south on the bottom of your screen here, moving up in here towards the north, the main channel ends up having these different points and flats that kind of stick out and catch a lot of that. So come down this big straightaway here, we're also seeing that this flat kind of sticks out here in the middle of that current. So if there's any current coming in here across the bottom, it'll pop over here where these drop-offs are as well, and it'll centralize a lot of these bait fish and a lot of these walleye that want to actively feed onto this edge over here. Other predatory fish are going to be out there as well, such as the white bass and crappie. Anything that's really going to be feeding up on shad are going to be sitting out there. So don't be surprised if you're catching a variety of species as you're doing this. You can still use the same baits I mentioned earlier in the video to catch walleye in the dog days of summer, but you will have to adjust trolling speeds and retrieves to have the same success, as these fish become a little bit more lethargic and more finicky during the heat. During the summer months in Missouri, we can have high pressure systems that bring clear skies and hot temperatures that drive fish deep. But once pressure change happens and we get to where we're having pre-front, or a cold front's just starting to come in, the walleye bite can be fantastic as fish feed heavy before big summer storms. In this upper section of the lake over here, it's a lot shallower like I showed you guys earlier, but there are still some really good walleye fishing locations here even during the summer. A lot of people come up here to fish this during the spring as the walleye make the runs upriver, but there's still some good holding ground for them to be, and a lot of people kind of like leave this area and search more towards like the main lake and mid sections of the lake towards Stockton itself and further north. But over here you guys can see there's a little bit of a white strip here. That's the old river channel, and it's really pretty defined up against this shoreline over here. Any current that's running through the dam kind of swings over along through this. A lot of bait fish are over there all the time. Good spot to hold walleye and other bait fish, and really can be a good feeding location for them. There's also this little hump that's over here. It's an old island in the old river system, and you guys can kind of see that it's not much of a like raise because it's coming out of 32 feet up to about 27, so it's about a 5-foot hump out there, and it's fairly large. There's a lot of bait fish to try to hold along to that, and walleye and catfish, all kinds of stuff kind of set up on there to feed. Same kind of situation as we had just a little bit ago, where that current and that old channel swing kind of comes up and smacks right against this bank here, and I mean, it runs right against the bank. So it's super deep right off the shore. There's also another little bit of a hump right there, as you guys can see by that blue, an old little island sitting over there. Comes all the way from like 34, 33 feet of water on the outside edge up to 27. So it's a little bit of a hump there. It's fairly gradual, but it is something that fish like to hold on to, especially during the middle of the day. And at night, a lot of times they'll kind of pop over into these little pockets where there's like a little side pocket here or onto this main lake point where there's just a little bit of a ledge. There's some different rocky structure over there. Some places there's like some flooded trees and timber that's in through here as well. This channel kind of meanders around over here. And then there's this island that comes over here right off of this point, this little saddle. The walleye kind of move up and around the shallow sections of this at night and kind of be off the deeper end here towards this river channel during the day. And the same kind of thing goes as we go further down the lake over here. We have another channel over here with a little bit of a cove next to it. This is a good area for those fish to slide up into at night to hunt bait fish. And over here we get the 40-foot depth again and the old river channel for those fish to slide back into during the middle of the day. That's really what I'm liking to see for this time of year, is deep water access next to shallow water, some different variations in structure, rock, and where current is going to be able to flow through whenever the dam is actually running something, so those fish can kind of move in and out and be able to stage to ambush prey. I showed you guys this spot over here already as we came by over here by Mays Creek and Masters. This little island over here is great. This little point that comes off over here is great. And there's another little point that kind of sticks out quite a ways offshore. Like, you don't really like see how far out it comes. There's a shallower section to it that you can see by land, but obviously there's a couple of little points actually that stick out over here. One that sticks out and comes over and jumps up out of 40 feet of water and all the way up to about 12, 11 foot, and kind of gradually like flattens out at that point over there. And then there's like almost like a little bit of a knob over here, shoots up to 7. And it's got a little bit more of a steeper grade to it. Moving down here towards the main lake and wherever those two major river channels kind of meet up at, I really like this right side of the lake over here towards the east, as we get a lot of really big points that kind of jet out over here. There's a really big rocky structure. There's an old channel swing that comes right in over here. Big boulders and everything. I've caught walleye there before. There's walleye all along these big points over here as we make in through these bends. As you guys can see, this channel over here is significantly deeper than what we just came out of. It's like 90 feet of water or plus, and then jumps up really quick and abruptly. Really depends whenever the bait fish are up here. There's lots of bait fish up there. The active walleye will be there too. And so just looking around on your graph is going to be huge and trying to find where those active fish are from time to time, because there's so many good walleye locations on this lake and different structures that they can use. Obviously, there's an island sitting out here in the middle of the lake that I've caught walleye around, and others that I've talked to have had great success there as well during this time of year, where they control all the way kind of around it. There's some steeper parts to the island, and there's kind of a spot over here where there's a flat that sticks off, and it's got more of a gradual taper to it. Really depending on where the bait fish set up at, but where the walleye are going to be at. Coming back down here towards the southern section of the west side of the lake over here, we're moving down, and I'm starting to see some of those other flats again where we were talking about earlier. There's one over here on the east side of the lake that kind of sticks out quite a ways. I'll zoom in on that here for you guys real quick. Part of this that like really sticks out to me is that it's not a very steep grade. I mean, you can see just how far apart those contour lines are. It's a very, very gradual, big feeding flat. But the only time fish are really going to be there is if the bait fish are there. There's not like a whole lot of structure to really say that would keep them there. Not like super giant rock or anything like that. It's just a big flat. East side, I spent a lot of the video talking about this big section over here where these big flats and points stick out where that river channel swings up into it. That's probably like one of my favorite spots to fish on the whole lake over here. And as we move further and further up, there's a really good area over here as well that I haven't really talked about, but it's got some flooded timber in it as well. So there's some more snags. Really a big point that sticks out over here is almost like a little bit of an island right here where it jumps up to 7 foot of water. And there's just tons of areas for these fish to set up at. And if you're new to this or you're new to walleye fishing, a big thing is just to look for bigger areas to try to target and structure. Like if you wanted to fish a section of the lake for the first time and you're trying to like scout out some new fishing spots for yourself, and I was just looking at this, I would be picking these bigger chunks of blue that I would be like, okay, this is a giant area offshore structure where there's a big flat or an island or a point or something that those fish can use, and I can really work over that, because the bigger it is, more likely there are to be some fish there on the structure at all. If it's really small, there might be like one or two fish, but if you have like a really big area, there could be several schools that are there. Some schools may be actively feeding, some may not be. You just want to try to be putting yourself in as many situations where the active fish are there as opposed to the inactive fish. Trying to find the bait fish will help you with that, like I've said before. Deeper channel swings kind of pop out to the outside edge where there's a really hard line over here onto the left side of your screen here, and then there's more of a flat. Those are going to be your feeding areas. The left side is going to be more of like where the inactive fish are going to be at. A lot of areas where current's going to be whenever there is current running through the lake. I mean, when I'm saying there's current, it's not more than like a mile an hour or something. I mean, it's pretty slow, but it is enough to reposition those bait fish and consequently everything that wants to eat. Other areas to try out over here would be over here by the where it says cybird on the graph, and also further up wherever the channel swings on the opposite end of that channel swing, like if it slams to the left over here where it says all this flooded timber is, there's going to be a flat on the opposite side of that. So like if you can kind of tell where the cliffs are on the lake, if you don't have a graph or something, you can kind of tell, okay, well, this is where the old river channel used to go. The other side is going to be shallow, where there's like a big drop off or a little bit of a lip there where it breaks over and there's a feeding flat. Without further ado, that's going to end this walleye breakdown. Leave me a thumbs up down below this video if you guys enjoyed this and found it helpful. I know a lot of people have been asking for me to do more walleye content on the channel. Comment below what you would like to see next on the channel. Until next time, everybody, explore deeper. There's more out there, and we'll catch you on the next one.